Welcome to the Outhouse Lounge, where we relax and talk about stuff. I'm Chris Gordani, your host. Many of us have wondered if there's other life out in space. Well, you hear the laughing in the background, so this is who's with me today. But many of us, we'll talk about that in a few moments. Many of us have wondered if there's other life out there in space, as if we were being visited. Why has the government been so tight-lipped about the possibilities, considering a former Pentagon official, driven, as he has publicly said, by his duty to reveal truth, claimed the U.S. government has been keeping crashed alien spaceships under wraps for decades? This has been, well, long thought about, yet always denounced as a conspiracy theory. With me is my rather cool panel to talk about this, so let's welcome them. I have Lieutenant Colonel Tony Shaffer. He's the host of The Hard Truth, former Special Ops Intelligence Officer. And I really can't go further than that, or else he'd have to kill all of us, or at least maim us. Is that correct?
I can't confirm or deny my lethal capabilities.
I have some great rockers with me. Cherie Currie from The Runaways, her solo work and the exquisite chainsaw sculpting. Jack Hues of Wang, Chung and the Quintet. And I like the Quintet, by the way. Cool. And Susan Olsen's with us, actress, perhaps quite familiar with this boxy, crowded on-screen arrangement. And of course,
Susan Ultra. Susan Ultra. I like
Susan
that.
Ultra.
Susan Olsen.
That's a UFO name.
This is what happens when I don't get my coffee in the morning, and I haven't bothered to get it yet. And of course, Jeremy Kennedy. He is the host or co-host of the Totally Rad 80s podcast, Dancing With Ourselves. Jeremy, thanks for coming back on with us. Mm-hmm. Elizabeth Breckenkamp is with us as well, and she is the co-host of The Hard Truth and fine voice actress. So we have a very diverse panel here, if you will. I like it. I'm a guy who supports diversity. So let's start here. It has come out. It has come out a Pentagon official spilled the beans on the government's keeping of crashed alien spacecraft. First, I kind of thought this was happening since I heard about Area 51. What say you all?
Are we talking about David Grush, or are you talking about someone else?
You know what? I'm just saying, what say you all? I mean, what do you think?
Oh, on that particular issue, yeah, of course they have.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So let me. It's like a lot of our inventions.
So yeah, if the basic question is the government hiding anything from us? Well, of course they are.
Yeah. Well, I've got to jump out here in a few minutes, but let me do what I normally do in shows like this. As an operative, I may know things, I may not. Nobody knows. I don't know. I don't know what I don't know. Just saying, you know. So, but what I will say is this: there's been ample evidence, to Jack's point, already in popular media, and this is called The Day After Roswell, written by Colonel Philip Corso. Now, this book, I was a young operative back in defense intelligence when I first read this in 1996. So I gave this to one of the graybeards, one of the old guys who was part of, I suspected, a program. And I said, read this book. Now, this book, the premise of this book, that something crashed at Roswell in 1947, that the pieces of technology were taken from Roswell to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton, Ohio, next to my alma mater, Rice State University in Dayton. That's interesting, since I went to college there. And then the other stuff went to Fort Belvoir, Virginia, in Northern Virginia, where, strangely enough, I was assigned there for most of my career. Not that it's a correlation does not mean causation, just saying, anyway, if you believe the book, and the guy, I said, how accurate is this book? And he said 80%. So if you take the premise of the book that a UFO crashed and the technology was dispersed, that means it's real. So to Jack's point, I think it's only logical that Pentagon officials are starting to come out now. So, and I highly recommend the book.
It was interesting back in 2000, I think it was, I actually went to Roswell. Yeah, I was on tour, and it was like a little sort of detour that we took to go to Roswell, and we spent the night in this kind of trailer park tour bus. And the following day, they have a UFO museum there. And there was a guy, well, the guy who founded the museum was Captain Walter Hout, anyway. So he was the guy who was the press officer at the Roswell Army Airfield when the crash sort of supposedly happened. And And it was just interesting to talk to him, you know, because obviously I sort of shook his hand and was slightly starstruck and just said, you know, so what did happen on that day? And all he could say to me was, you know, I was called into the office of the guy who was in charge of the airfield, and he said to me, I want you to put out on the wire, which is what they had for communication in those days, that we've retrieved a crashed flying disc, and that needs to be the sort of headline, you know. And so that's what he did. And he said that there was a lot of activity. And then after a couple of hours, another guy came into the room and said, you need to retract that and say that it was a weather balloon. And he said they set up the whole photo thing with the foil weather balloon and on all
that. I've seen that picture. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a famous picture. And it's a famous story, of course. Everybody's heard this stuff a billion times, I suppose. But it was just interesting to hear it from the horse's mouth, if that's the right phrase, yeah. You know, and the sincerity of this guy, you know, he wasn't saying that he saw anything, but he was just told exactly what happened to him on that day. And it was a powerful experience.
Hmm. Well, it's almost like, what was it, Attack of LA? Is what do we call that? The one with that big ship, that airship that was over the beach in Los Angeles, and we had all of our military firing on it, and there's photos of it. And because I actually shot a movie over at Wonderland. They were shooting from Wonderland, Susan, you know, the old base, that hidden base in Wonderland, up in the Santa Monica Mountains. And here, how are they going to, I think they tried to say that was a weather balloon too, even though it continued to stay there for, what was it, 45 minutes as we had every kind of military missile shot at it, and it just stayed there. I think, well, when was that? Was that in the 40s?
Right after Pearl Harbor. It was right after Pearl Harbor, the Battle of L.A. Yeah, they were shooting at it.
The Battle of L.A.
They could see it. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
And when you have people shooting at something, it's pretty hard to deny it.
Exactly. But they did.
So the question is, here's a question, though.
We're just a bunch of dummies, you see. That's all. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Bunch of dummies.
I do want to ask this question. For years upon years, we've been talking about the idea that this is a conspiracy theory. Aliens never come in certain areas, so why would they be, why isn't anybody else seeing them? Or why aren't there more reports? And why aren't prominent people seeing them? Now, over the last many years, we have seen presidents come out and say, hey, I've seen something. Carter, Reagan, they've done that. We have Congress members. And of course, some people who are a little more prominent, they've come out. Now, we also have a registry on the internet where people, thanks to the government, where people can report UFO sightings. This seems to be a big thing. So why now? They could have done this years upon years ago. Why now? Or is this the shiny keys or something for something else that's going on? What are your thoughts?
Well, right now they're destroying the country. So maybe if they get us to be afraid of something that's in outer space, we won't pay attention to the government that's destroying us.
Yeah. Well, I will say that we were just talking earlier before we went on air that it was about Philip Schneider, who was basically severely injured by a gray when he was digging the Dulce base. And he claimed that 2029 was when we were going to be invaded. And I'm thinking, well, they've got to start getting us a little more used to the fact that there's aliens, because I think he's right. I mean, Philip Schneider, God rest his soul. You know, I mean, he knows firsthand. I felt he knew. And anybody that doesn't know about Phil Schneider, look him up. There are some videos that are very old, but he is really somebody that you should look into. And he was murdered by the government as well, for his knowledge.
Suicided.
Well, he could have been just sent to the village.
Suicided,
He could have just
with his hands tied behind his back. Yeah, right.
A rubber hose so tight around his neck that he literally, his face was black. I mean, he was, how do you suicide yourself with your hands tied behind your back in a... and a rubber tube so tight that your head's about to pop off. I don't think so.
Yourself
in the back.
Now, there is now a place where government officials can actually As you can see here, the government officials can report that they have seen a UFO, or the new term UAP, I think it was.
What is that?
That's a non-UFO UFO. Yeah, it's I call it the politically correct version, but it's an unidentified something else. I have to get
that. Like a rebranding campaign.
Yeah, why do they do that? I mean, what was wrong with UFO?
There's a lot of stigma attached to the notion of UFOs. It's a joke.
I guess it's you don't want to emotionally endanger some of the aliens, I guess.
We offended the aliens.
Right.
But this is a place not for regular people, but for government officials to actually report UFO sightings, which I find rather interesting too. Is they're saying is what they're basically telling you is something's happening. We don't trust if you say anything, but we'll have some of our government people say a few things, and who knows if this is even reliable.
Well, it makes sense that actually if this invasion that Phil Schneider said was going to happen in 2029, 5 years to prepare us and get us frightened enough for this takedown of Earth, it kind of makes a little bit of sense to me. The fear factor.
Well, there's another question here. A lot of people think that it's going to be a great thing for the aliens to come here, for us to meet aliens. Maybe we can trade technologies. We can give them, maybe some new flavors of ice cream while they get us some nice centrifugal flight technology or something like that, or hovercraft technology that we didn't have before. All right, I am joking, but people just seem to look forward to the idea of meeting aliens. Okay, maybe a benevolent society would come and meet us. However, what might be more of a consideration is that what happens if it's a predatory society that comes and tries to visit us? They want to colonize or maybe destroy the planet, kill us, and take our resources. Are we playing with fire by trying to deliberately contact extraterrestrials, in your opinion?
I think so, and I'll tell you, I'm kind of the outlier of the group, I suppose. I don't necessarily have an opinion on whether I believe or not. I mean, certainly I'm open to anything. I live in Florida. I'm between two Air Force bases, so I'm constantly hearing things that I don't see. Whereas I feel like on this side, people that are reporting these UFOs, et cetera, I feel like they're seeing something more than they're hearing something, and I'm quite the opposite, from my perspective. But going back to your question, Chris, yes, as a Christian, it's like, where do the aliens fit into my world? Well, so many theories out there, and we could debate this all day long. You can go through the scriptures of the Bible and try to match things together. But I think, and this is my opinion, we all have opinions here. My opinion is that these creatures are, or this whole world, I don't think that they are sharing the same blood type that you and I are sharing. I don't see them being a physical body. And if I go by my scripture, my Bible tells me that God created all living things on the earth. And then, but the whole angel realm, those things were created, they're spiritual, and they were created to serve the purpose of God. And then, of course, with Lucifer falling from heaven, took one third of the angels with him. Well, what happened to those angels? Well, some people are connecting the dots. Maybe I know Billy Graham was constantly trying to tie the connections between demonic activity and alien. But this is not the first time this has been tried before. So, but anyway, if I saw something, first of all, it's going to make me wonder naturally. But if I encountered a physical being, I'm going to be very cautious. I'm not extending my hand because it doesn't fit with what, I believe personally. So,
I think that what's unarguable is that whatever it is, and there are various ideas these days that are current, which some of which is that they've been here way before we have, that they are earth-dwelling creatures. Other people think they're extraterrestrial. Other people think they're interdimensional. Mm-hmm. So they could be one or other or all of those things, you know. But whatever they are, they seem to be, from the craft that we observe, to be technologically superior to us. And I think from a military point of view, when you're encountering a technologically superior army, race, or whatever it is, you're screwed.
Yeah, pretty much. It could be.
Has anyone read Project Blue Book? Because I certainly did. The author said that there were 55 different species. And I actually believe that we are here because of the aliens personally. I think we have alien DNA. Even AB RH negative blood, which my son has, I mean, they say that that is also more towards the alien blood type. And otherwise it doesn't make sense. And not to put down your religion. I was born Catholic. I went through, you know, all of that stuff as well. The thing is I truly believe that we certainly didn't come from just Adam and Eve, because the diversity, the different kinds of ethnicity, just doesn't make sense with Adam and Eve. So I think that we're just all different species of alien and human. I don't know who mated with who, but...
genetics and the incest thing doesn't pan out anyway over those. But I understand where you're coming from here, and a lot of Genesis can be described as parable. Now, here's something to the idea that religion and these, I'm going to say it, ready? UAPs and again, unidentified aerial phenomenon. that's what it is.
Anomalous.
It's the politically correct term for UFOs.
The A stands for anomalous, I think.
Anomalous.
Yeah. So the idea is that the ancient civilizations used to, you'll see it in Egypt, but there are a lot of other ones that have drawn gods or beings that came down from flying chariots. This has been interpreted by scientists or an archaeologist, many of them, as maybe a possible real life experience where these ancient civilizations had met up with aliens who came down from the sky, and there was no other explanation by them. And that can also be legitimized by the fact that certain structures, landing pads, if you will, that are virtually identical, have been found in different hemispheres. You know, both sides of the world. Remote, and these are remote societies who have never went into contact with each other. And... Mm-hmm.
Well, look at the pyramids.
Right.
I mean, come on, the pyramids. We could not build the pyramids today. And you look at, I mean, it's impossible.
That's a different story.
I mean, you know, Stonehenge. I mean, it's just impossible. I mean, these have to have been alien helpers there, in my opinion. Has to be. It's just common sense. I mean, how it just doesn't make sense otherwise.
Certainly the massive question mark on pyramids and stuff like that, because you can't explain.
No,
you know,
can't.
How they were built within the time frame that we're told that they were built in. And so it is a massive question mark. And I think all that we're talking about is really a series of massive question marks to which the answers are unclear right now, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's very funny that we're so narcissistic to think we're the only ones in this universe. I mean, to me, it's just, again, human beings are the most narcissistic, selfish, me, I'm so great. And the thing is we are not alone. I've seen the ships myself. I absolutely know that they have been here far longer than millions of years, I believe. And, you know, I think... We are so lucky to be here at this particular time in history, because I think we're going to finally get the answers to all of these questions that we have today. I believe that with all my heart, and I think it's going to happen sooner than later.
I would hope so. But you have to think that governments, if these ships have been found or somehow escorted back here for some reason or another, you have to think that a lot of our scientists were reverse engineering some of these things, not unlike the rumors that were going around that the Third Reich was doing so during World War II.
Mm-hmm. Oh, right. So you think that's what led to the, what were you calling it? The Battle of L.A.?
Battle of L.A.
I was looking that up, and that was February 24th and 25th, 1942. That's when that happened.
Yeah.
That's so, weird that we don't, it isn't common knowledge, you know, and something that was that visible and witnessed by that many people. And I don't know, I thought it was crazy that I didn't know about it until I was in my 30s. But, you know.
Well, you know, if you go into most elementary schools and high schools today, at least in America, if you ask them anything about the Holocaust, I think most of the kids don't know about that either. And, right. And so many people don't know about it because they're not friggin' teaching it. Because they're more worried about CRT and,
yeah, right.
And DEI and teaching kindergarten kids that there are 52 different genders.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like 55 different aliens, right? Of course.
See, when you said that made me think of that. 55 different aliens and 52, what is it? 53
different genders.
Like, there's a correlation there, I think.
You bring this up, though. Our society's messed up in a lot of ways, okay?
Uh-huh.
How can you not think the aliens would have the same problem? Think about this. Civilizations would have to go through certain kind of evolution, and yes, social evolution as well. Maybe they're just as narcissistic as us. They're celebrity oriented, just like this world is in the first world, that is. And possibly we're going to run into some societies that are almost just like us that may have a little bit of extra technology that we didn't have, and vice versa. Mm-hmm. Let's say we're able to travel in the next 1,000 years. We're probably going to find societies that aren't quite as advanced as ours.
Maybe.
Maybe.
It just means that if something's more advanced, I think that we assume that they must have gotten over, grown beyond their primitive brains. Like, you know, a lot of what's wrong with us is that we still have these Neanderthal elements going on in our heads.
Well, you say that, but with our society's problems, our technology has advanced many fold from the Industrial Revolution moving forward. So think about that.
Yeah.
Okay.
But explain that, Susan. I mean, what do you mean by Neanderthal?
Tendency, you know, to be afraid of things that are different, you know, smash. There's kind of a root primitive brain urge to be violent. When afraid, I would say that probably describes it the best. To destroy whatever you don't understand, and when we get beyond that, it's easier to advance.
Well, I think there are lots of different humans. Aren't there? A lot of them are like you say, you know, but there are others have been, you know, mystics and saints, yes. You know, and spiritual advancement is a sort of something that a lot of people are interested in and involved in at various different levels, you know. So that's the thing, it's a whole spectrum of different things that we're looking at dealing with, I think. And if there's multiple alien presences, you know, then it's kind of like, I remember watching the movie, you know, Men in Black with my kids when they were little, you know.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, this is like a documentary, kids, you know, and they were like, don't be ridiculous, you know.
But it's a documentary.
You know.
I love that movie. Well, look at implants.
That is funny.
I mean, but what about the implants that they're now coming out with? I mean, people that have been abducted, and I say they have been abducted because I absolutely believe this with every fiber of my being. You know, now they're coming out with implants in the hand or what. I mean, to me, I just think that they've been rolling this stuff out, but people have been talking ever since I hate being 64. I forget names, but the couple, the interracial couple that was abducted, Betty Hill,
Barney Hill.
I'm gonna remember. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Barney. You know, well, they were talking about implants as well, and that, you know, these young, yeah, and it usually runs in families. I mean, yeah, the children,
Barney and Betty Hill,
right? So, you know, now they're rolling out implants where everything's just going to be, you just wave your hand over a cash, you know, a little pad when you're shopping, or you just walk into a market and it senses your, and you never have to pay for any. I mean, this is crazy stuff from.
I'm with you here. And this is important because there have been abductions. We know this. Yeah, if I ever get abducted, I'm pretty sure some aliens might be seeing this, watching YouTube, thinking, hey, who could I abduct this time? If they choose me, I would prefer the thing in my hand while I'm asleep over that that needle that goes in your eye from Fire in the Sky. Did you see that? Ooh. That thing was just...
Yes!
That was the most horrifying movie I had ever seen because I've seen slasher movies and I love them, but this I couldn't take it. You're like, it's going in the eye. I mean, the eye. The guy's awake. No!
I think they took liberties on that one. Well, you know, movie makers take liberties. I think that they probably did it, but some other way. But I truly believe that we're being impregnated by alien sperm. And can I say sperm? Alien sperm. And that we're being right. And these children are being raised by the aliens because all of a sudden you're pregnant and then you're not. And I mean, these are things that cannot be denied. And there are hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people that have been abducted that have claimed that they were pregnant, all of a sudden woke up and the baby is gone. And, you know, you don't like me too, you have to believe them. I believe these people. I don't.
I do too, because imagine having something like that happen to you. And then nobody believes you. But there's also, going back to what Jack was talking about with mystics and such, there is this spiritual element as well with a lot of the people that see UFOs. And they know they're going to see them before it happens. And there's a guy, and of course I can't think of his name, and I'm 62, but he's got this whole group of people. They'll gather in the desert, and they will the UFOs to come. And he's saying it's very, very spiritual. These beings want to warn us. They don't want us to destroy ourselves and the planet. But
I love him, by the way. I know who you're talking about. Marie met him, actually. And I've watched a lot of his podcasts and some of his short films. And I think he's wonderful.
Name?
I can't remember.
Gosh, darn it. Stephen Greer. Is that
there we go.
Right.
I do have something. Jeremy, you mentioned earlier that there's a correlation between obviously Christianity, faith, and extraterrestrials. You might remember just recently Congressman Eric Burleson out of Missouri had publicly said about the discourse about UFOs. I'm going to say UFOs. I'm not saying UAPs, all right?
I refuse to use that.
He says that extraterrestrial beings basically are angels, okay? Or when he uses the term angels, he says it's synonymous with extraterrestrial beings. I think that's the way he put it. What are your thoughts on that, Jeremy? Because it kind of goes with what you said earlier in the program.
Yeah. Right. Excuse me. The Bible is full of instances where these extraterrestrial beings or angels interacted with humans. And in fact, there's a scripture, and I don't want to quote scripture per se because there's different interpretations of the Bible, but there is a scripture that reads that that the tools that these angels have are not of this world. And when I think of that, I think of the tools that they have, meaning are they able to come in and out of dimensions? Are they able to, you know, take a saucer and defy gravity and maneuver it in ways that we just can't understand? And it kind of all makes sense to me. It really does. And I support the congressman's theory also. I mean, I believe this. I don't talk about this very often. I don't even know if Michelle and I even discussed this.
This is a safe space, if you will.
I'm in a little box here, though. But yeah, I agree with him. And that's, I think what you just said summarizes everything else that I have said up to this point. So, and I am not carrying this torch for Christianity and trying to correlate this with the whole UFO phenomenon. I'm not like that. I've never spoken about this, I don't think publicly, to anybody other than maybe my brother, perhaps. But yeah, I think it's great that we're all talking about this, because there's so many categories of different types of research and attributes. You know, for the government, I look at it, well, I want to think that the government is paying attention to this, because is this a threat to our nation? Is it a threat to the earth? You know, as far as science is concerned about what's the origin of these beings? What is their life expectancy? You know, we're looking at it from a man's perspective. And then, of course, you know, theology is looking at, you know, what do they have a religion? How do they assimilate? Do they group? Do they live together? Now, these are all questions that, and I'm thinking, you know, angels are all in heaven, but if a third of them fall, where do they go? They got to go somewhere. What do they do? You know, there's a whole chapter in the Bible about, and now I'm getting
the
off.
Fallen angels.
Oh, this is good. This is
right. The fallen angels, and they describe Lucifer because he was right. The leader. He was the one who tried to take the place of God, and God said, nope. And, you know, because of his pride, he. Yeah, that is interesting, because a third of the angels followed Lucifer. So they, or, you know, some names for them are demons, you know. But it's interesting that means two thirds of the angels did not. So it does make you wonder, like, and it kind of made me think of the Mothman prophecies. If you ever saw the movie or read anything about those, that's interesting too, because, you know, a lot of that happened in West Virginia. I don't think it was just West Virginia.
Point Pleasant, West Virginia. Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you. But I think there were like some sightings also in Pennsylvania. And even the movie was good. You know, Richard Gere and Laura Linney played the police officer. That's interesting, because even though, you know, like Cherie was saying, you know, from movies, they tend to, you know, like, dramatize things that probably didn't happen. But the basic premise is that all these different people who didn't necessarily know each other saw the same type of thing, where it was this just very large, kind of like the shape of a human, but the enormous wings and the red eyes. Every single eyewitness said the eyes were like they were on fire. And so that makes me think the same thing, because I was raised Christian. I kind of fell away, then I came back. And I think the same thing. Instead of like trying to say, is it either the Bible or aliens, I think it can be both. I mean, it would make sense that one third of the angels who fell away can take these different forms, you know, that can kind of like, morph isn't the right word, but they can take different forms and appear to us that way. And I think the Mothman prophecies is a good example of that. Anyway, that's my thoughts. Anybody else ever know much about the Mothman prophecies? That was really good.
Yeah, the Mothman prophecies is a really terrifying film.
The red eyes.
That's a good example of this interdimensional aspect, you know, that it's in the realm of sort of paranormal, I suppose you would call it, as opposed to, because I think with UFOs, UAPs, we tend to think that we're talking about nuts and bolts, machines and beings of, well, not flesh and blood exactly, but beings that stand in the same space that we do. Whereas with paranormal stuff, you know, you're talking about beings, ghosts, whatever it might be. You
things
know,
that we don't really understand.
Go out of dimension and they go out of it again, sort of thing, you know. And, you know, so I think that the confusing thing about UFOs for people who are not into it and maybe listen to this and sort of think, you know, that we sort of lurch between being reasonably objective about it, and then being very kind of unobjective about it, you know. But one of the problems is, you know, this paranormal aspect to it, you know, that it's not a normal phenomena that you can kind of tie down with scientific method. The scientific method doesn't really help us explain it at all. And you're always down to sort of eyewitness stuff and
that's
blurry
a good point. Yeah.
stuff, you know. So it's a very difficult subject to get people into, and there's no one thing that you can say, I don't think, that is for a skeptic to suddenly go like, oh, I get it now. Yeah, so they must be. I think over the years, you know, you read different books, you hear different stories, it doesn't go away, and you start to see this overarching pattern of people stumbling across information or actually experiencing things themselves, you know, like a Phil Schneider type character, you know, and the constant government denial is always been. So, and then it's, I think when you get this bigger picture and a lot of information, you start to sort of realize, well, there's definitely something going on. And, you know, a lot of it must be close to the truth.
Well, there's a show that I keep binge watching. My sister and I hooked on it. Caught on Camera, Paranormal Activities. And there's a ton of UFO stuff. And the thing is, we have cameras all the time. We have a camera on us. There are cameras, you know, set up the closed circuit TV. And we are capturing more and more and more of all of these phenomena. And among them are the UFO phenomena. And it seems like there's more and more people who are saying they knew something was happening before they got out their camera, before they saw it and then got out their camera. Like there was a psychic connection.
You know what baffles me a little bit are these civilizations that have gone lost, the Aztecs, the Mayans. You look at, again, Egypt, you look at just how and people just, because history only seems to go so far. And then it's almost like we had to start over again. Maybe we're entertainment in a way. See if what actually is going to work for us to be more enlightened beings. I'm not exactly sure. But I am usually, like with the Aztecs, you look at these amazing civilizations that where the people just disappeared. They just, boom, gone. Yeah. And I mean, I'm
for one. Shift. Where the equator becomes the north and south poles.
Oh yeah, the polar shift. Maybe. That's right. And this could happen again. I mean, I'm not saying soon, but if it happens again, it could cause some real problems too. But think about that. The polar shift, when it happened before, we could have lost a lot of civilizations. Perhaps, I mean, I'm now going far fetched here. Perhaps in Atlantis, which could have been an alien colony or an advanced society, maybe that. Just got lost and destroyed.
They've also found skeletons that are, 8-10 feet tall?
Right.
I mean, that's, come on. That doesn't make any sense. It's common sense. You don't find...
In the Bible, too? The giants?
The giants, yes.
Oh, right,
But again, you look at Egypt, you look at all of these hieroglyphics?
Yeah.
And you see that there are aliens there. There's spaceships. There are alien beings. And then all of a sudden, boom, everybody is gone. And there hasn't been a true history for us. And I truly believe that we're going to witness it. I think we're going to witness I think they've been here for millions of years. I think they are underneath our feet. At Dulce, I absolutely believe that. I believe Philip Schneider. And I know the government knows. I know they've made dirty deals. And a lot of people have been abducted. And that was a deal. And I, again, my age. Now, I forgot the president that was supposed to have met that alien on the aliens on the runway. And one alien who stayed, and there's photographs of him, like at the Pentagon or something, with this alien that's 170 years old. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? I mean, that alien that was helping.
President Eisenhower, wasn't it? In 19-
yeah.
That's right. That's right. Really? Now we're not talking about that.
He made a deal that the aliens could only abduct so many people, and they ended up breaking that deal. The aliens did, because they got a little sick and tired of, you know, playing around with us folk.
To know what exactly what was said and what went on. You know, I mean, it's just the very, if it happened, the very fact that it happened, I think, is kind of mind blowing.
Now, we don't want to confuse this guy with the Weekly World News alien that comes out every election cycle
and predicts who wins
the president.
Oh, gosh.
That alien always picks the winner. I mean, that's just the way it works. But anyway, I'm going to figure the alien backs. Maybe he'll back RFK this year. So who knows? Yeah. But I do want to get to this question then. Could there be aliens living among us and us not knowing? As per that little agreement you were talking about, Cherie, just a few moments ago, or maybe something else?
Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm just going to say right out, yeah, absolutely they are. Yeah, for sure. Go ahead. I'm saying yes.
Mayans are a hybrid, and you know the people that are descended from them are. They have these wonderful almond-shaped eyes, and who knows?
Mm-hmm. I think the Swedes, for sure, the blonde, blue-eyed, beautiful people. You know, I think that they definitely are. You know, the aliens are
the Norwegians.
Norwegians, yeah.
Okay, so you know it's interesting that you pointed that out because my brain goes everywhere when you said Swedes, definitely because of their physical features. So you know, I'm sure a lot of us did the ancestry DNA and that type of thing. So I know I'm part of me is Swedish, German, Irish, African, also Welsh. So does that mean that if you do your ancestry and of course ancestry DNA is not 100% correct. You know, there's always there room for error there. But does that mean that if you're part Swedish or part whatever you're just saying, Welsh, that's possible that you and I would have some kind of alien DNA? Because I know you'd mentioned that earlier, Cherie, that you think
absolutely.
All humans do. Okay.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I never thought of that theory, but that's interesting.
Hmm. No, that would vindicate my elementary school teachers from back in the day.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, Chris, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Elizabeth.
No, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, Chris, your question was, are they among us? You know, maybe, but I can say, since I'm correlating, you know, my religious beliefs, angels with aliens, good or bad, that's yet to be determined. But I do know, you know, I've had encounters. We all have. We've all met people that came into our life for just 5 minutes, but somehow it changed the course. Mm-hmm. It maybe took us on a different path. One time I was a admission clerk, for lack of a better term, at an amusement park. And you had to get your hand stamped if you left the park and came back in. Well, this kid, I never saw him. He left the park somewhere and came back in, or trying to come back in. And I'm asking for his hand stamp. He has no hand stamp. And so I turned him away. Well, 5 minutes later, his dad came up to me and was ready to just, you know, break me in half. And I was a scrawny little guy. I was probably 14, 15 years old. And suddenly this man, I have no idea who he was or where he was, but he stepped in behind me and he defended me. And he was making a verbal threat at the guy who was threatening me. So, and the next thing I know, this guy is gone. I have no idea who he was, where he came from. And I'm on top of a hill. The amusement park was below. So the parking lot was high. This guy came out of nowhere. And I am convinced to this day that was somebody that my God sent to me on my behalf. And I can only refer that as an angel. You know, maybe I'm nuts, I don't know, but that's just my personal
belief. I understand. No, that makes sense to me. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
This guy was gonna hurt.
That's a good story. And you still remember it, yeah, because it scared the piss out of you.
I've seen two UFOs. We were talking earlier. The very first one, I was in seventh grade, and it was hovering over the Sepulveda Dam. Everybody saw it. It was on the front page of the LA Times, for crying out loud, when I was only 14 years old. My twin sister, when I was shooting a movie called Parasite, terrible movie, never. Demi Moore's first movie, by the way, she denies, but I mean, she never talks about it. But we were out in Lake Piru and driving home from the set, my sister and a friend, Marie had a moon roof, and they're driving down the 5 freeway over by you, Susan, and they could see it. And it was a mothership, and it was black and hovering over the 5 heading towards Los Angeles. And as they went underneath it, they could see all the components, and it was enormous. It was like a mountain. And that, and she saw it, and you know, if only we had had cell phones back then, they would have gotten pictures of it. But you know, and then I saw one just last year in Arizona, very close, and it came down and it was cloaked. And because it was like this grayish with almost like a burgundy overtone, and I could feel it coming, because like we were talking earlier, there's electricity in the air. It drained my cell phone, drained my electronic cigarette, but I mean, it came right down, and it was like, oh my God, it was amazing, and it was silent, so I think we got to buckle up, buttercups, because finally, they can't deny it anymore. And I think we're all just awakening to just, first of all, just the absurdities that's going on around the world, right? It's absurd what they're doing to people. A friend of mine reached out saying Canada is now a communist country. They're locking everyone down. They removed a Trudeau flag from a friend's. The police came, and I mean, so we're really becoming a police state, mm-hmm. the world as a whole. And I think that's now we're after COVID. We're kind of primed now for the next horror show, and that's going to be this whole threat of alien invasion. No doubt in my mind.
The alien emergency, if you will. There we go. The alien health emergency. So that's what's going to happen.
But if anybody in our mission would be an alien, Anthony Fauci perfectly fits the description of an alien.
No doubt.
Yeah. Or
no
a garden gnome.
But you're insulting aliens.
Yeah, I was thinking it.
Because he just lies constantly. And it's like,
Yeah, Jeremy, you wanted to...
sorry.
Jack, I just wanted to know, Jack, how does a guy with your background, your success, what was it about the whole phenomenon that has captivated you and that you're so interested to join us today for this conversation? What happened in your life?
I guess, I moved out of London about 30 years ago, and I met people who were into this subject. You know, in London, I only met people who were into sort of shopping and looking good, I suppose. And, but out here, and I say out here, I live in Canterbury, which is a sort of a city, you know, out of London.
Oh,
but,
okay.
But I went along to a couple of talks that a friend of mine had organized, where they were talking about, one of them was by a guy called Richard Hoagland, who wrote a book about the face on Mars, which was a sort of a thing in the 90s, you know, gone off the boil a bit, that one. But anyway, I met all these people who were talking about UFOs. They were talking about the Philadelphia experiment, all this stuff, which I knew nothing about. And I was kind of amazed that I knew nothing about it, you know, given that I, by the time, you know, toured the world, I thought of myself as a fairly sort of, you know, worldly person, you know. And I started reading books. I got a book by Timothy Good called Beyond Top Secret. Above Top Secret, which I'd recommend to anybody who is starting out on the subject. You know, I was thinking about this before we spoke. You know, how would you encourage someone to get into the subject? I'd say Timothy Good's Above Top Secret is a great starting point. And there's a movie by James Fox called The Phenomenon, which I think is absolutely a must watch. You know, that's full of very solid examples of UFO encounters, both the machines and the beings, and a particularly striking a sort of mass observation of a UFO that happened in South Africa. So, you know, once you get into the subject, I think it becomes very compelling, you know. And I suppose by the end of the 90s, there was The X-Files, there was Dark Skies, there were these shows that were kind of like sort of explicating this scenario of contact and all of that stuff. Not that I was a huge fan of the X-Files particularly, but it was, I think there was a rather like now, there was this sense of like the millennium's coming up, there's going to be disclosure, you know, it's all going to happen, which it didn't, you know. And I think that's salutary, because it could well be that we have this sense of like, wow, you know, we're right on the edge now of some sort of real confirmation, really by central government, which is what it's got to come from, really, you know, that we are not alone, you know. But well, whether that yeah. happened, I don't know, you know, because I can understand why, you know, we all live in consensus reality, right? We all agree that you know, this room I'm in is real, and, you know, that politics is real, and all the stuff that we sort of read, you know, but we're sort of encouraged to think that UFOs, UAPs are not real, you know, basically by the legacy media and stuff. And maybe there's good reason for keeping it out of consensus reality, because once it becomes accepted in consensus reality that they're real, then they are. And then you're kind of facing the real kind of fact of not being alone, of encounter, of dealing with, being with a race that's technologically superior to you and so on. And I can see that that's really challenging, you know. And I think when you are in this subject, just to finish up, you know, when you get really interested seriously in it, you have a few sort of sleepless nights, basically, when you start to realize that it's deep and it affects everything, you know. It means that life would never be the same again if we all started to really have to accept that it was a real phenomenon.
Well, I believe absolutely. I mean, I'm already way past that personally. I mean, we're on the brink of nuclear war here. We are on the brink of what's gonna take us away from that. Would be aliens and the fact. I mean, that would just stop it all now, wouldn't it? Wouldn't it? It would stop, because then it's all, you know.
So here's another question. I want to take this to the next, a different level here. Tony Shaffer is back with us as well. Let's say we are being visited or have been visited, and the potential of, let's say, a takeover attack or maybe even new technology comes into question here. We do have a lot of, or the world's powers have a lot of satellites now orbiting the Earth. We're generally controlled by our grids, and probably more so if certain policies are pushed forth in the next 10 to 15 years. How badly could we be crippled by an alien attack, even if it's just even a computer attack? Or are we ready to defend ourselves against an alien, I'm not even going to say invasion, but maybe interference, if you will? Tony?
Well, I'm with Cherie on where I'm at belief-wise. I've actually seen things. When I was a kid in the Philippines, I saw something that was a UFO. It was three large balls, black balls, connected with a large thing. And this thing was 150 meters by my estimate. And it flew silently across the mountains right outside of Clark Air Force Base in the Philippines. So I don't doubt it. And to Jack's point, I think the public was prepared for some of the things we're talking about by the X-Files. I know some folks, Jack, who were writers, and I think they were given hints on things that were going on. And I think that's why we're all kind of going here. So to reframe your question, Chris, a bit, I actually drove with my son around. We live in the middle of nowhere in rural North Carolina. So we have to drive an hour to get to any big city. So we went shopping. And my son and I were talking, he's 17. And it's like, we recognize we live on a very special planet, no matter who you are. I think the fact we have a stable planet, if you look at all the other planets out there, the billions out there. So we are, I think, a very magical place. We are blessed. With that said, I don't think it's by chance we're here. And I think that the idea that man could do stupid things to get us in trouble, I have no doubt that we could be very stupid as a species. I've seen the stupidity firsthand. I've seen the avarice. I've seen the greed. Cherie and I have talked about this a little bit. I got an environmental studies degree because I actually am concerned about the environment. I want to see us preserve the environment in real ways. But with that said, I think there are forces out there that are invested in the Earth continuing no matter what. And mm-hmm. We may call those aliens. We may call them, you know, one of the other series I liked and enjoyed when I was a kid was Battlestar Galactica. And ultimately, there were things out there trying to help the human race survive. So if you look at Battlestar Galactica, the original series, not the new one, which I love, James Olmos did a great job with all the new cast. I'm not casting aspersions on the reimagined Battlestar Galactica. I love it. But the idea of the original Battlestar Galactica was maybe there's forces out there that'll help us survive. So, Christy, to answer your question, I think there are things out there that maybe we don't fully understand that aren't necessarily out trying to invade us. They're trying to basically make sure we don't do something that was so stupid to ruin the bounty and gifts we have now before us. So that may be a bit radical to look at, but I don't believe that we're going to be invaded. So
I think that they're already here, Tony. You know, they're already here. I don't think they're just going to come out of the ground or wherever they've been, you know, and
there's a great scene. There's a great scene in episode 2 of the X-Files where Mulder's on a track running. I don't know if you guys remember this. This is like the second episode.
Huge fan.
Yeah. And so the guy comes walking across the field and says, "You've seen things you weren't supposed to." And Mulder says, "They're here, aren't they?" And he says, "Mr. Mulder, they've been here a long, long time."
Longer than.
I was watching an interview with Bob Lazar and Joe Rogan.
Yeah,
that's a very interesting interview to watch. Bob Lazar, I think, is an interesting guy who came out in the 80s saying that he'd worked at Area 51 and he'd worked on reverse engineering the technology, you know, the alien technology, you know. And during this interview, he sort of, you know, Joe Rogan sort of saying to him, you know, where do they get this stuff? Do you know what I mean? These crashed discs and so on, you know. And Bob Lazar says, well, my understanding is that some of it came from an archaeological dig. And I found that really sort of mind-blowing. Do you know what I mean? That this is, you know, these guys, as they say, you know, with toothbrushes kind of going through some rocks and stuff, you know, suddenly come with some huge metal thing in the ground, you know. And that sort of, in a sense, gives you maybe a little bit of perspective on that, when talking about they've always been here, you know, like for thousands, maybe tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of years.
Of course. What about alien autopsy? I mean, you can't, I mean, the best makeup artists in the world said that this was impossible for them to have been able to make that alien happen. I mean, that's a real autopsy of an alien.
Well, it's very
Have you seen it?
Oh, yeah, the old film you're talking about, right?
Old film?
The old one, yeah.
It was in the early 90s when that was came to light, the alien autopsy, black and white. Yeah. Right. I mean, they had every major makeup artist, movie makeup artist, say that this just is impossible. I couldn't do it today, what is on this black and white film. And when you look at it, I mean, it's obviously an alien, and that is. But the fact that they continue to turn around this government of ours is to think that we are that stupid that they could turn around and say that is faked. It's an insult to me now. I'm insulted by them. I'm insulted by our government thinking that we are that stupid that we can't handle the truth. You know, it's obvious to a lot of us.
Exactly. That
this is real.
Is the British government, are they as aggressive, going to what Cherie said, are they as aggressive about hiding information?
Yeah. Yes.
Much more so
as the state?
More so here than in, because I think there is a sort of, if you like, an enlightened lobby that wants disclosure or at least some sort of loosening of the secrecy, or even just acknowledgement, not alone.
Well, the monarchy would be gone. I mean, there would be no queen, there'd be no king, there'd be none of that. I mean, they would, I would think they would be have to do that to keep the whatever the heck, you know, that is all about.
I think,
well, you know,
over here, that was the, you know, Rendlesham Forest. Are you guys familiar with that?
Yeah.
Yes.
I've seen films on that. It's great. Yeah.
1980, I think, wasn't it? Sort of Christmas to New Year, 1980. And, you know, that's a pretty well-researched story. And a book came out last year, I think, by a guy who's really gone into massive depth about it, you know. But things like that are just simply never reported here. And there's a sort of jokey kind of skepticism still about the subject over here, I think, you know.
Well, Jack, I was actually on Australian TV a while back with a former British intelligence official who's been trying to disclose all this stuff. I don't remember his name, but he's been on Ancient Aliens. He's been on a bunch of these other shows, which I love Ancient Aliens. I mean, I love that. I got to tell you, I watch that stuff. And
Graham Hancock.
I love Graham Hancock. He's rewriting history the way it should be written because... Jack, have you ever been to the pyramids?
No.
You should go. I recommend everybody go because right next to the Sphinx, right next to it, there's this massive block of rock, 100-ton rock. There's no way we could move 100-ton block. And, and these things are, I mean, literally, it's four times the size of the room I'm in right now. This thing is huge. And I'm standing next to it. I'm thinking, how is it people don't recognize that there's no way we could move this today? We couldn't.
That's what we were just talking about, Tony. Right. I mean, that just the pyramids alone should make people sit back and say, this is impossible. We couldn't do it today. You know? So, it's incredible.
I don't get it. Incredible.
Not. Right. I do have to close this particular episode out. We have to do this again, maybe continue this discussion in the future, find out more about what's going on, especially as more is revealed from this former Pentagon official that's going to be talking a little bit more or singing like a canary, if you will. We'll have more coming out, and maybe we're going to, as I said, we should do a part two of this sometime in the future.
Well, yeah, but we definitely need them to start talking because, like Tony also agrees, that we've got a nuclear war coming our way, and we have got to something's got to give now. We're really at that point in history that I think we are just a bunch of dummies, the people that lead this world, and so you know, blame it on the aliens, right?
It's always good to find someone to blame it on. So exactly. Can I just leave it with this? I was reading something online, and it's an op-ed, but it's from a scientist. And so this is an interesting thought. If aliens contact humanity, who decides what we do next? Who gets to decide? Because scientists setting up their post-detection hub in Scotland are concerned that all humans will react like headless chickens. Anyway, so that's an interesting thought. Who gets to decide what we do?
Headless chickens? Yeah. I don't know about that.
And before you blow us all up,
that's what the scientists in Scotland said. Right. We'll react like headless chickens.
Yeah. And before you blow us all up, just tell us what's going on. Okay, that's basically what we'd like to do. We'd like to know.
Hey, can I ask Jack one last question?
Sure.
Is Tony Blair an alien?
Tony,
there you go.
I'm curious. I don't know. You know, I mean,
I think
some of the attributes.
I think you're an alien, Tony. I mean, when I met you at that convention, you had this like weird glow, and I was like, wow, is this guy like human? You could be an alien.
Sauna. That's why he was in the sauna.
The truth is out there, Cherie.
Yeah. Yes.
As we close this out, I want to thank you all for being with us. Susan Olsen, Jack Hues, Cherie Currie, Tony Shaffer, Elizabeth Breckenkamp, and Jeremy Kennedy. I appreciate you coming on. We'll do a part two of this in the future. And yes, we are being watched. They might be among us, but they are out there. Thank you for being with us. And
thanks, Jack.
And look over your shoulder.